عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. May Allah bless them and bless every single one of us. And may Allah grant us all goodness. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, the best of names, according to the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أَحَبُّ الْأَسْمَاءِ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَعَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ. The best names that are most loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Abdullah and Abdul Rahman. So a lot of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began naming their children Abdullah and Abdul Rahman. Subhanallah. The slave of Allah and the slave of the Most Merciful. May Allah make us truly from amongst His slaves. Today we are speaking of two of our heroes. Once again, from amongst the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we want to get to know them a little bit better. So when someone says a name, we should have an idea of who the person was. The first that we will be discussing this evening, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu. He was born in Islam, which means he was born already when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a messenger, and he was born 3 years prior to the hijrah itself. So as he was born, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who was asked to do his tahniq. Tahniq is when a little date is chewed slightly and it is taken, placed into the mouth of a newborn with a slight bit of saliva. It would be rich in iron and at the same time high in spirituality. This is known as tahniq. To this day the Muslimin do this following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this young child, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because his father was Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's father was Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib. He was also a cousin of Ali ibn Abi Talib, because Abu Talib ibn Abdul Muttalib was also an uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this young baby who was just born 3 years prior to the hijrah. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was invited to do the tahniq. He did the tahniq, and this young boy, as he grew up, he loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much. It was amazing. He spent a lot of time with him. He would be within his home and within his room most of the time. This was Abdullah ibn Abbas. So much so that he says, I used to prepare water when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to make wudu. And I used to travel with him on the same animal a lot of the times. And I used to walk with him most of the time. And he used to carry me on his shoulder a lot of the times. Subhanallah. This was Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He says, whenever Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray, I used to stand up as a little boy and pray with him. You know, we see little children when we are praying, our own children. May Allah make us steadfast and make our children steadfast as well. We see them pray. So he says, I used to get up and pray. And one day Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pulled me from the back and pushed me right so that I could stand next to him. And I went back. I sprung back to where I was behind him. So when he completed his prayer, he said, oh, Abdullah, why didn't you stand right next to me? He says, oh messenger, I respect you so much and I love you so much. And I have so much of respect for you. I cannot stand in the same line as you, subhanallah. So I stood behind you and I will always stand behind you. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made for him a dua. There were two main du'as, supplications that were made by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for this man, and it was accepted and it was noted in his life and the companions knew about it, radiyallahu anhum jami'an. One was, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once, whilst he was playing on his shoulder, he says, Allahumma faqqihhu fi ddeen wa 'allimhu at-ta'wil. Oh Allah, give this young boy a deep understanding of the religion. Fiqh is not just knowledge, it is a deep understanding. This is why a lot of the times I have a prayer that I normally like to say for us all, may Allah give us a deep understanding. This is where we get it from. So Allah says, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, give this young boy a deep understanding of the deen. and grant him knowledge of the interpretation of the revelation, which means tafsir of the Quran. And truly, later on, this Abdullah ibn Abbas was known as Habrul Ummati wa Turjumanul Quran. He was known as the jurist of the Ummah, the one who had the most knowledge in jurisprudence of the whole Ummah. And he was known as Turjumanul Quran, which means the one who had the deepest knowledge of tafsir and the revelation and why verses were revealed and what they meant. And yet he was a little boy and he grew up. This is what he was known as. So from this we understand, do not underestimate the dua that someone makes for you, especially if that person is a pious person. May Allah bless us all, grant us piety, and may we be from amongst those who really become happy when someone prays for us, noting that the most powerful prayer is when you pray for someone without them even knowing that you have prayed for them. May Allah grant us the ability to pray for one another, and I here request that you pray for me and we pray for you and the entire ummah. May Allah bless us all in every single way. Ameen. The other dua that was made was Allahumma atihil hikmah. This was the day when he was taken from the back and put to stand next to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he went back. That day Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, oh Allah, grant this child wisdom. And it is reported that he became such a wise youngster, so much so that the people of, meaning the Muslimin of Quraysh and even the Ansar and the other Muslims, they used to say, he is a child, but a very wise child. He's like an old man. You know, sometimes you have a little child, but their movements are like old people, and we get excited. This, in the real case, he was a youngster who grew up, and subhanallah, not only wisdom, but he was very, very mature from a young age, subhanallah. He used to listen very carefully to all the discussions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he used to listen to the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam very, very carefully. So much so that he was asked one day, how did you get your knowledge? He says, I used to ask a lot of questions. Subhanallah. You know, our children, they ask questions. Sometimes we say, keep quiet, you're not supposed to ask. No, that's the wrong answer. Give them the answer. If you don't know, find it for them. If you don't know, take them to someone who will answer their questions. It will increase their knowledge. May Allah help us all. So he was a man, or he was from his young days, he used to ask a lot of questions, but he had a certain beauty about him. Something amazing is he used to listen also very carefully, very attentively. It is reported that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, when he spoke, everyone listened to him. And when people spoke, he listened to them very carefully. Amazing. With us, a lot of the times we're on WhatsApp, I think, or we're on BBM. Even when your own father or mother is speaking to you, we're still busy, you know, sending people messages until your mom sends you a message on the same application. And then you say, oh, sorry about that. I hope we apologize as well. Nowadays, we are becoming more and more rude. May Allah grant myself goodness and all of us. I think we get overtaken. This Sahabi, Al-Jaleel, great honored Sahabi, when people used to talk to him, he left everything and listened very attentively. He gave them importance and he was loved. Subhanallah. Now, if we take a look at how desperately he sought knowledge, if he heard that there was a hadith after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, remember he was only 13 years old when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. If he heard that there was a hadith that one of the companions had that he had not yet heard, he would go to their door in the afternoon. And had he knocked, they would have opened the door because he was the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he used to take a piece of his clothing and lay it at the door, and he used to lie down in the heat, and he used to go to rest there or lie down there and wait for a while until the companion came out for salah. As they opened the door, they would see Abdullah ibn Abbas. What are you doing here? He would say, no, I've just come to seek a bit of knowledge. Well, why didn't you knock the door? Well, I wanted you to rest, and I knew that when you came out, I would be able to speak to you. No, you are the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Had you called me, I would have come to you. Why did you even have to come here? He says, no, I was taught to respect those whom you want to seek knowledge from. Without respecting them, you will never be able to seek knowledge. So much so that Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu cried one day. He says, this young man, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he waited for me at my door. As I came out, he rushed towards my conveyance, the animal, and he grabbed the animal and helped me onto my animal, and he held the reins of my animal, and he's walking. And I said, oh, Ibn Abbas, why are you doing this? He says, you are a teacher, you've taught me something. He says, you are a family member of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are embarrassing me. He says, no, this is how I've been taught to look up to my teachers and to respect them. I am helping you because I respect you for the knowledge I've learned from you. And thereafter, Zayd ibn Thabit says, I asked him, oh Ibn Abbas, show me your hand. So he showed him the hand. So Zayd ibn Thabit got hold of it and kissed his hand. So Ibn Abbas says, why did you do that? He says, because you are a family member of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. May Allah grant us a bit of respect from those we learn from. A lot of the times we have teachers who've taught us goodness, we harm them later on in life. And this has happened a lot. It is a test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who teach us alif and ba, when we become 50, 60 years old, we think of how to harm them and how to hurt them in the biggest and best way. A'udhu billah. This should not be the case. We should respect them to the last moment. So this was the man. It is reported that at the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Abbas was so intelligent, so full of knowledge. He told Ali ibn Abi Talib, you see these people who have come out of your obedience, let me go and speak to them. So Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu says, what do you want to tell them? What will you tell them? They won't listen to you. He says, no, allow me to go. So then he was allowed to go. He went to see this large group of people who had some bad things to say about Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. So he asked them a few questions, but first they did not want to talk to him because he was young still. And then he said, no, I would like to say a few words to you. So some of them said, okay, this man is a cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, listen to him. He asked them two or three questions about why they were doing what they were doing. And each thing he responded with a verse of the Quran and explained to them, or a saying of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and explained to them. In a few moments, he had turned the bulk of them back to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. In a few moments, this was the intelligence of the man, the wisdom of this young man. Masruq ibn al-Ajda' was a tabi'i. Tabi'i meaning he was not a companion, but he had met the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rahmatullahi alayhi. Masruq ibn al-Ajda' says, Abdullah ibn Abbas was the most handsome of those I saw. So when I used to see him, I used to say, this man is the most handsome. When he opened his mouth, I used to say, Subhanallah, this man is the most eloquent. And when he used to start speaking, I used to say, Alhamdulillah, this man is the most knowledgeable. So he had three things. He had eloquence in language, he had deep knowledge, and he was very handsome in his looks. This was Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, the youngster who grew up with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or under the guardianship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a man, every single day, he used to have gatherings at his house. So much so, that nowadays, we describe it as the first university. Because he used to teach subjects. He was a master in tafsir. He was a master in jurisprudence, which is known as fiqh. He was a master in history. He was a master in the Arabic language and in what was halal and haram and so many other things. So he used to specialize every single day for a different topic. And the people used to gather at his house and he always allowed them in and he always prepared some form of food or drink or fruit for those who came in. And he considered it an honor. So those who were his students, they were invited to his house, students meaning they wanted to seek knowledge from him. And on top of them, he used to give them food or drink. Imagine, with us, even if we get a visitor in our house, may Allah grant us ease. I don't want to say what goes through the minds and the hearts of the people of today. You know, I once visited a house with my mom when we were young. And the door had a sticker on it saying, we are very happy upon your arrival, but we will be even happier when you depart. Allahu Akbar. Imagine. That's today's times. May Allah grant us ease. I'll never forget this. May Allah forgive us all. I just hope it was a joke and it was not serious. When I told my mother what had happened, she said, I never want to go back to that house. It's something true. Anyway, to get back to Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was an ustad and at the same time, he used to honor those who learned from him as well. Not only his teachers, but even those who learned from him. Because he used to say, it is Allah who sent them to learn from me. This is a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using me to spread this knowledge. But he was a very, very humble person. So, it is reported that on one occasion the people came to his house. So much so that his own friends used to say, we've never seen the streets so full as we have close to the house of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, the gullies and alleys. So full, there is no place to walk. So one of his friends went into his house after having found his way in and he says, oh Ibn Abbas, you are resting, but the people are all outside. So many people, the largest gathering we've ever seen. So he says, let me make wudu. So he was helped to make wudu. And after a little while, he says, call the people in. Ask them, whoever wants to ask about the Quran, you can enter now. When they entered, he answered all their questions as best as he could. And then he told them, there are others who want to come in. So they left. Then he says, whoever wants to ask about halal and haram, enter the home. They entered the home. After they left, whoever wants to ask about laws of inheritance, enter the home. And after they left, whoever wants to ask about Arabic language, because he was a linguist and a great poet, you can enter now. And this is how he was known as the great university of knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Umar ibn al-Khattab, as great as he was, and the other khulafa, they used to call this young man in order to seek his opinion in so many of the major issues and incidents. And some of the older companions told Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, you're calling this young man? Come on, there are older people than him. He says, wallahi, this man is a knowledgeable man from the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the dua that was made for him. He is such a knowledgeable person that I will definitely ask him and I will definitely seek, subhanallah, his opinion. So on one occasion, Ibn Umar, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu asked him a question and said, in fact, he asked the companions a question. What do you people have to say about the tafsir of Surah An-Nasr? إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ Allahu Akbar. That is the surah, short surah. We all know it off by heart, I think. What is your people's statement about the tafsir of the surah? So that surah is mentioning the time Allah is saying that when the victory comes and the help of Allah comes and you see the people entering Islam in great groups, in huge armies, they enter Islam, then glorify Allah and seek His forgiveness, for indeed He is most forgiving. That in a nutshell is the meaning of the surah. So some of them said, well, it is telling us that when you see victory, you must thank Allah. Some said it is telling us that you must be thankful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Others said, we don't know what it means, and others were quiet. And then he told Abdullah ibn Abbas, what do you say? And he was the youngest of the lot. He says, this surah was revealed in order to show us and to show Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that his mission has been accomplished and his death is near. Subhanallah. So the others looked and they said, how do you know this? He said, I know because of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After we had victory, the mission was accomplished. When the mission was accomplished, Allah is telling him, seek forgiveness. And now he would prepare to meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amazing. So Surah An-Nasr, it was Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu who said that the tafsir of it, it would include the fact that it is informing that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his mission has been accomplished and his death is near. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and grant us ease. He was one of those, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, who used to have such a powerful memory. He used to remember all the rulings of the time of Abu Bakr and Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu and the likes. He used to remember it all. Anyone would ask him, what did Abu Bakr say about this? He would know. What did Umar ibn al-Khattab say about this? Radiallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings be upon all of them. And subhanallah, he was a man who used to say that I love goodness for all the people, even those I don't know, I make dua for them. When I've heard of a good ruling made by a ruler, I pray for him. When I hear of rain or goodness that comes to any one of the Muslims, I thank Allah on their behalf and I pray for them. He says, when I have even a little bit of knowledge, I desperately want to share it with as many people as I can, even though I don't know them. And he used to cry a lot in his salah. And he was a person who used to prefer peace than war. And he had a preference. He always used to say, give preference to peace over war. And give preference to kindness over being harsh. And give preference to explaining rather than instructing. Now, what is the difference between explaining and instructing? Something amazing. If I were to tell you, fulfill your salah, that's an instruction. But if I were to sit you down and explain to you why you need to fulfill your salah, you will be so convinced that you will want to do it. And this is how we should be treating our own children. This is the teaching of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. So he was one of those people, subhanallah, who was a great man. I want to quickly make mention of one of the beautiful hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu was with him, he says, I was with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a young boy. And then he looked at me and he said, Ya Ghulam, O young boy, احفظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ. Look after your obligations unto Allah and Allah will protect you. احفظِ اللَّهَ تَجِدْهُ تُجَاهَكَ. Look after your obligations unto Allah and you will find Him with you, coming to your assistance. You will find Him right ahead of you, subhanallah. And he continued to say, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. When you ask, only ask Allah. When you seek help, only seek the help of Allah. And you should know that if the whole nation gathers together to harm you, they will never be able to harm you unless Allah has written it against you. And if the whole nation gathers to give you some goodness or to benefit you, they will never be able to benefit you unless Allah has written it for you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us from that. He passed away when he was 71 years old in the year approximately 68 Hijri, and he died in the city of Ta'if. He was from amongst those whom Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan was the Khalifa, and he had come in for Umrah with a large group of people. This was the Khalifa of the Muslims, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan radiallahu anh. When he walked in and he came into Mecca, he had a large group of people with him. And he noticed an even larger group of people. And when he asked about them, they said, those are the students who are now with Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. So he had even a larger following, subhanallah, during that particular hajj. Our next hero is the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. His name was Abdullah as well. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. He was born 1 year before prophethood. So he was born just prior to Islam. When his father accepted Islam, he was 1 year old. So he too was a youngster. He grew up as a Muslim, and subhanallah, he was the closest in looks to his father, Umar ibn al-Khattab. People used to miss his father, come to him and just look at him, subhanallah, because he was the closest in looks to his own father, Umar ibn al-Khattab. He too used to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He made hijrah to Madinah Munawwara with his father. The day his father announced, I am making hijrah. Anyone wants to follow me, see me on the other side. This little child of his was with him and he made hijrah with his father. The battle of Badr came in and Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu was only approximately 12 and a half years old. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him back. He was too young. He cried. He really wanted to take part in the battle. Then the following year, Uhud, he was still 13 plus years old. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him back. He cried again. In fact, he was standing like he was tiptoeing, trying to look big. And he made his shoulders look broad and he had a sword that he came with. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him back, told him no. And when the battle of Khandaq took place, he was approximately 15 years old. And then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed him. And subhanallah, thereafter he took part in whatever Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took part in as well. And he was an amazing young man, subhanallah. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattabi radiallahu anhu did not lean towards the dunya, towards the world. Whenever he earned something, he gave it away. Whenever he ate, he always made sure that the poor shared the same food that he ate every time he ate. If they didn't, he would not want to eat. And we will give you some examples of that in a few moments. He was a man who was constantly found in the masjid. It is reported that if you went to the masjid, you would always find Abdullah ibn Umar there, radiallahu anhuma. May Allah bless them both, him and his father. One day he saw a dream, and in his dream, he saw that two angels were taking him towards the fire. And so he started saying, A'udhu billahi minan nar. May Allah protect me from the fire. May Allah protect me from the fire. So another angel comes in and says, oh Abdullah, you don't need to worry. You don't need to worry. Nothing is going to harm you. Anyway, he got up from his sleep quite worried. And he told this dream to his sister, who was the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hafsa bint Umar, Ummul Mu'mineen radiyallahu anha. So she was the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my brother has seen this dream. My little brother has seen this dream. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, what a good man he is. If only he reads extra salah at night. Abdullah ibn Umar heard this radiallahu anhuma, and he says, from that day, every night, whenever my eye opened, I got up, made wudu and read a little bit of salah, tried to sleep again. And his friends and his family say that every night, 3, 4, 5 times a night, he would suddenly get up, make wudu and read some salah, because he was worried about this dream that he had. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you will have paradise by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obviously he was not from amongst those who was directly informed that paradise is from him. But this narration or this dream was good news for him that by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will have goodness, but he would need to continue praying at night. So that is exactly what he did. And some amazing stories of this beautiful companion, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma. It is reported that Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu during his time tried to appoint him as a qadi. Qadi meaning a judge. So he refused because he did not want to be a leader in this world at all. He was so careful of the hadith. He narrated so many hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he was so careful of the wording. He was one of those whom if he was not sure of the wording, he would not narrate it. Although the hadith, you're allowed to narrate it with a slightly different wording if you are not 100% sure, for as long as the meaning is not changed. But the Quran, you cannot do that. But he used to do the same as the Quran with the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he told Uthman ibn Affan, I don't want to be a judge here. So Uthman ibn Affan told him, you know what, you should be the judge and we would like you to be the judge. Your father was appointed the judge in the presence of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So do you know what the young man says? Radiallahu anhu. He says, my father was appointed as a judge in front of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He judged with what he knew. When he didn't know, he would ask Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he didn't give the answer straight away, he would ask Jibreel and he would get revelation. And I don't have that anymore. So I don't want to be a judge. Subhanallah. What a man. So Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu thereafter excused him because he said, look, O Uthman, if someone seeks the refuge, if someone seeks refuge in Allah, surely wouldn't they be granted refuge? Uthman says, yes, they would. He says, well, I seek refuge in Allah from being appointed as a qadi or as an imam. I don't want to be appointed as either one of them. So he was not. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu acknowledged that and he gave it to him. He said, okay, that is fine. Then when it came to the confusion between Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah radiallahu anhuma, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon all of them. Some of the companions said, oh, Abdullah ibn Umar, we want you to be the Khalif. And he said, I will never ever be the Khalif. How can I be the Khalif? I am just an ordinary Muslim. So they told him, no, you should be a Khalif. Your father was a strong man. So he looked at them and he said, okay, if you appoint me as a Khalif and you pledge allegiance to me as a Khalif, what will happen to the people of the East who would not want me as a Khalif? So those who wanted him told him, well, if they don't adopt you and accept you as a Khalif and pledge allegiance with you, we will fight them. And that is when he said his famous statement. He said, never ever let that happen. I would definitely prefer never to let Muslims fight because of me and because of Khilafah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us and may He grant us ease. This Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he turned that down very strongly and he warned the people about fighting because of Khilafah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us and grant us all ease and goodness, and may He grant us peace and stability across the globe. My brothers and sisters, this was the man whom he used to follow the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the T. Do you want to hear what he used to do? When he used to go to Makkah, he used to stop at a certain place and he used to water a certain tree. So they asked him, why are you stopping here? He says, because once I traveled with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he stopped at exactly the same place. And this is where he stopped, so I will stop here. And what happened also, subhanallah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he arrived in Makkah, his camel went round the Kaaba twice, just on its own. So whenever Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu used to go, he used to make his camel go round exactly how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's camel went. They asked him, is this something we need to do? He said, no, it's something I just love to do because my most beloved used to do this. And it happened to him once. It happened to him once. So this man used to follow the footsteps exactly of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If he found that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked in this direction, and when he got to a certain place, he bent a little bit when he walked, Abdullah ibn Umar used to walk. When he got to the spot, he would bend his head a little bit and carry on walking. Although there was nothing there anymore. But this is the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he had. Now, This man used to love the poor and the orphans so much that he used to make them eat with him. So one day, his wife, Safiya bint Abi Ubaid, radiallahu anha, she was told that, you know what? I want to have some fish. I want to eat a little bit of fish. And obviously he was a man who ate very little, very little. He was very thin. People used to complain to his wife, why aren't you feeding him? So she used to say, I cook for him whatever he wants to eat and I cook for him the best of food. But every time he goes to the masjid on his way back, he sees these beggars and he comes back and gives them the food. So what should I do? So she used to go out to those beggars and give them something prior to salah and tell them, please move out of the way of this man so when he comes back, he doesn't see you. That's what she used to do. So still one day he had a fish. And this is an amazing story, we need to listen. So she cooked it for him, she found it and she made it very well and very nice and she put it in front of him to eat. And as he's thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his meal, a beggar knocks on the door. So he tells his wife, give him this fish. She says, but oh Abdullah ibn Umar, how can I give him the fish when I struggle to make it for you? You haven't eaten for so long, you need it, you are so thin, you are weak, you need to strengthen your body. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu never ate to his full, not even once. He used to say, we are people, in fact, he used to say that we are people who will, when we eat, we will not eat to our fill. Subhanallah. This was a man. He used to eat in order to be able to worship Allah. Not eat as we do in order to enjoy the food of today. Everywhere we go, we hear makan, makan, mashallah. May Allah grant us ease and goodness. That's something Malaysian, alhamdulillah. Anyway, so here is Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He says, give the beggar. So she went to the beggar and she said, you know what, I have this fish, I've been told to give it to you, but my husband, he would like to eat it, meaning he wanted it. So the beggar says, well, you know what, I want it too. Subhanallah. So she says, okay, I tell you what, I'll give it to you, but I'll buy it back from you. So she gave it to him and then she took a dinar and she gave him the dinar and he said, okay, that's excellent. I'll take the deal. And he gave back the food. So by that time, Abdullah ibn Umar came to the door and she looked at him and said, you know what? I gave him the food and I bought it back from him and he's so happy. So he looked at the beggar and he says, are you happy with what happened? So the beggar says, yes, I got the dinar. Then he looks at his wife. He says, now you give him the food because now it's a charity. Subhanallah. And he made sure that that fish was given away. Allahu Akbar. Even though he wanted it so much. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness and make us people who don't live to eat, but rather we eat to live. So this was the man. It is important for me to mention a few more stories of this man. Abdullah ibn Dinar radiallahu anhu says that one day we went out with Abdullah ibn Umar for Umrah radiallahu anhuma. And on the road we saw a shepherd, and the shepherd had quite a lot of sheep with him. And Abdullah ibn Umar, he was such a kind man and he loved pious people and good people, honest, upright people. So he looked at the shepherd and he says, oh shepherd, give us one of your sheep and just tell your boss that, you know what, a wolf came and ate it. So the shepherd looked at him and says, Abdullah ibn Umar, he says, what answer will I give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? My boss, I can tell him anything. What about Allah? I can't cheat him. So Abdullah ibn Umar was so touched by this that later on he bought the slave and he bought all those sheep and he freed the slave and gave him all the sheep which he owned. Subhanallah. This story has repeated itself recently. If you'd like to Google the story of a Sudanese shepherd, just Google it, you will find it inshallah. In fact, on YouTube, you will find the story. Something very similar to this story that happened at the time of Abdullah ibn Umar repeated itself last year in Saudi Arabia. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness and ease and make us honest. Consciousness of Allah at the time when no one is watching besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another quick story of this man. Once he was given 20,000 coins. And he distributed them straight away. Like I told you, he didn't want to keep them. So when he finished distributing them, some people came and said, do you still have anything you're giving? He said, no, I don't, but hang on. He went to those whom he gave and said, can I get some credit from you? Can I please, can you lend me some of what I gave you? So he got it back from them as a debt and he gave those who were asking and later on he paid that debt. Imagine. Subhanallah. This was the man and this is how great he was. He was a person who used to say, the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kun fi dunya ka annaka gharibun aw abiru sabil, live in this world as though you are a passerby, as though you are a stranger or a passerby. And he used to always say, oh my beloved brothers, when you have seen the morning, don't think that you're going to be living at night. And when you have seen the night, do not think you're going to be alive to see the morning. Don't wait. Prepare with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet, he lived for almost 85 years, a little bit more than 85 years. And when he was 85 years old or a little bit more, in the year 73 Hijri, he passed away in Makkah al-Mukarrama and he was buried there. These were our two heroes that we spoke about today. The idea is just getting to know them slightly. One was Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. The other was Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma. Why we say anhuma is because we are asking Allah's blessings for both them and their fathers, as they were both companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah grant us the companionship of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the akhirah. Ameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.